Welcome. Welcome to my very first State of the College address. Thank you very much for being here in mass. It's great to see as many of you are interested in finding out what's going on. And today is exactly 4 months since I formally began the role of President of Keeler College. It's been a fantastic 4 months, actually sometimes it feels like 4 decades. Because a lot has happened since I joined on July 1st. But before I invite you, I start with my presentation and to allow more people to come in. I'd like to thank our interpreters for the good work that they do. Lisa Zeller and Chris Kapp will be helping us with interpreting services. So I would say that a lot has happened. When I became president of Keeler College, I was actually in China, graduating about 200 students. And it was an interesting experience. Then I came back here, and I have met with many people, and in groups. As you know, I'm going around meeting the various units. Also individually, the faculty, meeting the faculty one-on-one in their offices, so I can see what kind of books they read and what the state of their furniture, for example. And I have seen 34 people so far, one-on-one. I believe I'm only about halfway through, so that's been exciting. The comments that I get are very invigorating, and I usually end up with two or three questions, and some of you have heard me say that. One question is, what makes you the proudest of being associated with Keeler College? Whether it's something that exists today or that could exist in the future. And I have gotten some interesting responses. And some of you actually have sent long emails saying, I didn't have time to ask your questions, so here it is. So it's been very, very good indeed, at least for me. So today, the tradition is to give you lots of information with lots of numbers. I will be quick, as on the first part, the parts that have to do with numbers. Mainly because this information exists in the fact book and will be available on the website. And my presentation, by the way, is being taped. It will be available on somewhere on our website, and it's being transmitted via Adobe Connect to some of our faculty that are distributed in our state. I believe we have 5 or 6 faculty connected to 10. That's fantastic. And so I'm just saying hello to our colleagues out there. Thank you for everybody for being here. So let's begin with the numbers. Of course, the format is one of the things that we always look at very closely. This chart shows the undergraduate traditional students, the ASAP undergraduate students in kind of reddish color, graduate students in yellow, and international undergraduate students in sort of light purple at the very top. As you can see, in some areas we have remained pretty much constant. Some others have grown a little bit. In the graduate side, we run a little bit, came down, and we seem to be on an upstream trend. One of the things that I'm using is this convention that some of you have seen before. And I put everything in one symbol. The arrow indicates whether that number changed from the previous year. So if you see the arrow going up, that means that the number changed. upward from the previous year. And I'm referring on that arrow there that is colored green as the total number of students that we have here in the United States, 1,762. Then you see four numbers around, and it's a question mark, three numbers and a question mark. So the numbers at the top left is the maximum of value for that variable that has been in the last 6 years. By the way, I use 6 years because 6 years is very meaningful. That relates directly to the graduation rate history, which is 6 year graduation history. So it's very useful to look at 6 years chunks of our past. The number on the bottom left is it on the left? Yes. It's the lowest that number has been, and it's 1,431. And the number on the bottom right is the average of the last 6 years. The question mark is a number that should be our goal. Okay? Since we're working on a new strategic plan, I decided not to put any of the goals, only because sometimes it might confuse the presentation. So, the color green means that a change from last year to this year is good. Right? We have more students. Hopefully, we'll have more revenues. We're using the facilities better. But it could be that an increase like this could be color red if we are maxing out the capacity and we don't have space for classroom, dorms, stuff like that. And I've seen that. I've seen schools that say our enrollment is growing by 1. So they call it, you could call it red. In our case, I think green is good in all these senses of the word. Okay? So the next chart will be quicker because I don't need to explain the meaning of the hours and the numbers and things like that. So let's go a little bit deeper on what these numbers mean. And this is the freshmen and transfers every fall. Okay, so the bottom chart shows the number of freshmen that we have. And the bottom chart, the bottom, the top bars are the transfers. Okay, so you can see how they're growing. So if I apply the same principle, then I see that it went down from the previous year. So we call that red, because that might not be as good. And again, the highest value is 345, the total of these two bars. And the lowest value is being 347, the average is 330, and the current value is 328. A little bit about the first picture. Let's see if I can go to that one quickly. Oops, too quickly. This top here, oops. Where's my cursor? Right here. This top here is international students. So let me dig into that a little bit because you can see it better in this chart. So these are the international students that we have here on campus. So the total is about 91. Okay, which is roughly 10% of the students here. And 37 are graduate students and 54 are undergraduate students. The China headcount, so these are students outside the United States. Okay? The trend seems to be going down. This is headcount. So, of course, I show an arrow. And the highest we ever had is 45-15, and the lowest we ever had is 29-60, which is happens to be this year. Okay? I'm coloring red, but remember that the goal is a question mark. So the color of the arrow should really be related to the goal. Okay? Since we've seen that we have less students, less revenue, and maybe this is not as good. But again, take this with a grain of salt. There's not much science behind this as yet. Vietnam is growing nicely. These are full-time equivalent. You can see that it went down from last year to this year. But not the headcount, and it had to do with the cohort that we got the year before. We were put in an accelerated mode because I don't know exactly why, but I think it's because they could do that and graduate sooner. Gary, did that do justice to your explanation? So we do have many more students today than last year, but taking less courses. So the full-time equivalent comes down. The other number that is important is, of course, retention. Okay? So this is what's happened in the last 6 years. In the last 2 years, there's been a trend upwards, and we're now at 71%, so obviously that's good. Okay? I agree a little bit with the numbers, that if we increase the retention to 85-90%, we actually end up with a huge problem. We won't have place for students to sleep. So maybe a good problem to have. But as you can see what I'm saying, it's these numbers, we need to have an overall picture of where we want to be in terms of enrollment capacity and so on and so forth. It's a step function. Okay? So when you reach a capacity, it's always the N plus one student is always a profit until you hit that wall that you hit, you have to go the next step up. Build new dorms, build new classrooms, hire new faculty. And then it continues to flat, and then you hit it again and so on and so forth. Discount rate. This is how much scholarship dollars we give out, either ourselves or using the federal government or whatever. And this is the rate. And if I use the same symbology, then the arrow is red. And then this is the discount rate for everybody. And again, it's about 48%. The endowment, that's the money that we, the interest, the money that we have going on in investments, this is market value of invested funds. It's nicely going up. Okay? I don't know how we changed it today, but it is happening now. However, the endowment really needs to be looked at again in a window of about 5 to 6 years, a moving window, to make any sense of it. But right now it's about $7 million, and it's the highest it's ever been in the last 6 years. So in summary, if I wanted to give you a complete picture of the college, that's what you'll see based on these numbers. A few reds, a few greens, and then you could just look at these things and decide where you want to put your priorities as you move forward. Okay? This leads me to the budget for this year. And even though the incoming class was a little bit down, the returning students were up, then we made the budget for this year already. And regardless, these are still things that could vary. You know, in the spring, we may have students that could not come back. And then we have a pinch. So I have instructed the A team that whatever happens, we have to have a balanced budget at the end of the year. Okay? So far, everything looks good. But you never know until you reach June 30th. In terms of last year's budget, we actually achieved, I can't get credit for that, I wasn't here, a surplus. And again, I have instructed the A team to use extreme austerity in using those funds. And in fact, I intend to return back to the endowment wherever we took out last year. Since we had a profit, we didn't need it, put it back. We could grow it now. Okay? And that's my intent, that's what I told the board. And so far, I think we're going to do that. At least part of it, if not all of it. That leads me down to a topic that is very important to all of you, and then the salary increases. We kept our word, things are on track as planned. All of you received a 2% increase this year. You see the paycheck? Yes or yes? Right? As of October 1st, for the faculty, I mean for the staff, and August 18th for the faculty.
Staff will see the increase next pay period. Faculty have already received theirs.
Okay, thank you, Jerry. But it's retracted to October 1st. We're also right on track to be able to add an additional 1.5%. Okay? We're watching the numbers very closely, and an answer will be made within about a month of whether we're going to be able to do the extra 1.5%. This is fantastic in this economy. Talk to your colleagues in other universities and other colleges. Friends in the public sector have not seen a raise in 3-4 years. Zero. And many in the private sector has been flat or a very minimal 1% raise. So the fact that we're able to do this speaks loudly about how much we value the talent that we have in college. So that's the first part, and I've only used about 15 minutes, so that's not too bad. So let me tell you about what I plan to do this first year. I already started doing that. And basically it has to do with an assessment of where we are right now. If you don't know where you are, the best map won't help you. You need to know where you are. And then future plan is, you know, where are we going? What can we do? What are the interesting things to move into? Again, if you don't know where you're going, you can say, no, you get there. You may not be where you want to be, but you get there. So we want to do an assessment and we want to do a future plan. So I have broken down our plan of work for the next 3 years, and some, I apologize, some of you have seen this before, into three main set of activities, and they have already started. So the first set of activities is to establish a baseline, institutional baseline. For that, we need to, we're following, we have a book club in the A-team, and we have all kinds of books guiding us to make all these decisions. So for the indicators, we're using a book by Simon and I forget the author's name, where they identify 20 factors that combined can give you a picture of the health of the institution. And we did fill out those factors. I need to thank Jerry Hiller and his team for working hard on this, getting those numbers. And we are still getting more information, and you will see the report that I'm trying to put together, which will contain where we are on those 20 factors. Right now, we are about and 7 of those 20 factors we are in red. 2, we are in yellow. And the rest, 11, we are in green. But as I said, we're still populating those with more information. The peer institutions is an exercise that we started several weeks ago, trying to identify characteristics that will allow us to select a list of peer institutions against which we need to compare ourselves. And the idea is that we will place ourselves the median of that list. So if the list is 29, we will be 14 out of 14 now. If the list is 35, then we will be on that middle. If the list is 21, then we will be number 10. That's the idea. So the idea is that the ones above you are aspirational institutions, and the ones below you are where you're about to go in the future. Okay? And this moves, by the way, because you move up and improve, then you select new institutions. Some fall off the list and some are added at the top. So you're always in there with some to look at, and some to look below. This is a work that our Vice President for Academic Affairs is leading and Dr. Ann Mead, and we had input from just about everybody in the college. She just came out with a summary. I think there are 51 characteristics that have been identified by everyone, faculty, staff, and ministers. And she's in the process of analyzing the data and come up with the top, however many characteristics, so we can build that list. We also started a discussion on vision and mission, and sometimes it's difficult to figure out which one is which, and we spent quite a bit of time discussing that. And I'll say a few more words about that in a minute. This work already started, as I said. And then we also want to do a more thorough analysis of the institution. So we want to do what we call an academic program review, as well as an administrative services review. The first one I call, are we being effective? In other words, do the programs that we offer allow us to achieve our mission and our vision? That's being effective. And by looking at the administrative procedures, are we being efficient? Do we have the right resources in the right place? Can we move things around so that we can be more efficient in achieving our mission and our vision? So, establishing a baseline, I already talked about this, so let's get it. Reaffirming mission and vision, I like that word, and again, we're borrowing that word from one of our books that we're using to inform us about the process. Because maybe we don't need to change our mission and vision, we just need to reaffirm it. Okay? So this is but I feel that the need to focus and adapt to changing forces, changing conditions, changing circumstances, and to come up with a compelling vision so that we can have lots of good students knocking our doors, I think it's imminent. I think we need to do it. We need to come up with a vibrant, exciting vision for the college. And the mission has to do with why do we exist? What is our purpose? Okay? The vision is what we aspire. Excellence. You know? How does our vision define the world as a better place? Because that's what we want to be. That's why we exist. Then the institutional assessment will have at least components that touches the curriculum. What should the core curriculum look like in a liberal arts institution in the 21st century? It's an interesting question. What programs and areas need to be strengthened, expanded, maybe reduced, compressed, combined, consolidated, eliminated, new areas created? I don't know. Let's look at that. And then the last one is where can we use the resources once we have an idea. So what is leading to is an exercise in a strategic plan. Okay? Our current strategic plan was designed to carry us through 2012. So this is a perfect time to do the exercise again. It also coincides with the self-study that we're doing for middle states. So, and it coincides with the arrival of a new resident. It's almost like a perfect storm for doing strategic planning. So I'm very excited about this. So there are the very first components that have to do with defining mission, vision, and core values. And then you identify directly, you do an analysis of external and internal strengths and weaknesses that you run on. And then you identify your priorities, your goals, and your strategic initiatives, how you want to measure results. And then once you achieve those strategic results, you're going to have effective programs and efficient processes. which needs to satisfy students and motivate faculty. That's really why we do this. Okay? And I hope to count with the support of all of you, and you'll see how you can help with that. So that's the second part of my talk, which is what are we going to be doing this year? What's the next step? I thought hard about this, and then I said, I don't know if I need to bring this because I don't want to sound too negative. To me, the glass is half full, always. But we need to look at the marketplace, and that's our major threat. Our primary asset is the curriculum, i.e., the faculty. Okay? And that's the only thing that we have to conquer the marketplace. So we started looking at data that is available. It came from the Center for Educational Statistics just about a month ago. And this is what they're planning, they're telling us what might happen in the next few years in terms of the United States enrollment in higher education. There's going to be an increase of 13% in the next 10 years. The past 10 years, there was an increase of 43%. Okay? So we're going to have, by 2020, about 23 million students in the United States pursuing higher education. 1 million of which are going to be foreign students and growing. Actually, 1 million of which we're going to reach this coming year. You can see the numbers there, okay? The highest percentage of people going to college are 25 years and older. More women than men. Minorities are huge numbers coming into higher education. Okay, only a 1% increase of white students. This is from the Center of Educational Statistics. What kind of degrees are we looking for? They tell us that they want graduate degrees. 21% increase in bachelor's degrees, 32% increase in master's degrees. You can read the numbers. Professional degrees, those are, you know, low degrees and things like that, 30%. I wonder if nursing is part of a professional degree, is it? Nursing is considered a professional degree? Maybe not. Yeah, it is. At the master's level? Yes. So, I'm learning too. And this is interesting. Only about 4% of all the baccalaureate degrees awarded in the United States are awarded by liberal arts colleges. So whatever the number is out there, these smaller ones tend to come to places like Cuba College. This is where everything is going to happen. There's going to be a 1% drop in high school graduates in the next 10 years, in the US total. But if you look at the parts that are in white, the Northeast, is a drop of more than 5%. And the ones that are in gray and in kind of a brownish, there is an increase of about 15%. So Texas, Nevada, Montana, all those places. So what is that telling us? Well, that we probably need to become more national. Okay? Because if we keep to our demographics, that pool is shrinking, not just for us, for everybody in the region. New York has more than 200 colleges and universities, 217 I believe it is. Okay? And about 105 of those are institutions like ours, or similar. So what do we do? I think we need to start with why. I wish I could carry credit for this, but no, it's Tim Stark. Where's Tim? Thank you, Tim. That was a great idea. Where are you? I don't see. Oh, great. That was Tim Stark. Yeah, he's a late guy. So. Start with why. Why do we exist? Why are we here? That little book, and in fact, Pete, you saw the TED presentation and he said, oh, I saw this great presentation. He said an email, I saw this great TED presentation about this thing, start with why. I said, Pete, that's great, that's the book we're reading. And basically what he says is that the organizations that know why they exist are very successful. And that they don't focus on what they do, but they focus on why they do it, are very successful. So I started scratching my head, only to see where we are. And I found this, and again, I need to thank Caroline Marcus for providing this quote. But our mission is the magnificent transformations of ordinary citizens into superior men and women who shall bring strength to the nation and help to humanity. Who said that? Is that great? That's fantastic. And in fact, I believe that. I think that's great. It's really going back to the basics. And that's why we exist. That's why we do. We had a retreat. And I don't know if I should say this because it's been taped. It will be for posterity. But we produced gems, Polish stones. And I really mean it. It's unbelievable. The number of students that we have here, they go to graduate school. The way that they communicate with our visitors, we have a bunch of business people come from RIT, from Rochester to Cuba a couple of weeks ago. They were just blown away by the tours our students gave them. When I talk to the faculty, I can't believe I have such a good commitment and good job that we do in the classroom. I have been in the classroom, but just talking to them, I just know that they will do a tremendous good job. So that's why we need to focus on the curriculum. That's going to be our main arm, if you like. So the question is, 21st century liberal arts education, what is it? You know that liberal arts educations prepare the future leaders. Okay? It was another TED presentation I saw the other day of this person, I forget his name, he's from Ghana. He worked for Microsoft for about 12 years, made money, and then he says, I'm going to Ghana to try and forge the next generation of leaders. And you know what he did? He created the very first liberal arts college in Africa 2 years ago. I believe, because he says, that's what we need. We need liberal education to create and forge our next leaders. So we have something that is really, really valuable here. And I'm so glad that I was given the opportunity to come here. So I'm asking to do a soul search. I'm asking, what are the qualities that are centered in our institutions that will remain valuable in the 21st century? And the more I think about it, the more we have it. It's science, math, and humanities. No matter what. You could be in the 22nd century or the 23rd century. You need science, math, and humanities. And of course, the arts. So, I think that could be our focus. And that should be our focus. So, what is the curriculum of the future? And here I'm speculating. How should I put this? I'm not necessarily preaching here that we should do this. It's just an example. And Steve Jobs said it very well when he launched the first iPad in January of 2009. And I have this view, and he used this chart. He says, technology and liberal arts need to work together in the 21st century. And I said, he's absolutely right. Not only the technologies need the liberal education, but the liberal educated people need technology. It's my bias. But I think it's a win combination. Here's some examples of what we might create. Teachers that are ready to teach in the 21st century classroom. Criminal justice graduates that are experts in solving cybercrime with a huge amount of digital forensics. Scientists armed with computational methods. Is Casey here? Casey? She's not here. Our biology teacher. How are the birds doing? It's my favorite story. Nurses proficient in as medical informatics, which is the way in which things are moving. The digital health records, the electronic health records, whatever they call it. OT professionals using technology. I was given a tool by Gene. Is Gene here today? I know I'm putting people on the spot. And she showed me the community skills map. It blew me away. And the use of what we could do using technology. So I remember a project that I was a little bit involved with at Georgia Tech called the Aware Home. It's a home that is aware of its inhabitants. So it's a house that they built with hundreds of sensors to allow individuals to live in their homes the longest possible time, assisted by technology. Just to give an example, they have this picture framework where you can see a picture, but it's really a screen. And the frame was made out of butterflies. One butterfly per day of the month. The butterfly could be colorful and big. It could be colorful and small. It could be grayish and small, or grayish and big. So give you a pictorial information about the state of the person in that house. So if it was colorful and big, that person was active. But it was active doing good things. If it's gray and big, that person probably went to the bathroom a lot. And it was sick. Okay? They have RF identifiers, I don't know if you know what that means, but it's a little device that identifies objects with a radio frequency. So they knew how much milk they drank, how much everything. They have all kinds of information. Unfortunately, they had to close it down because of privacy laws. The bathroom had built-in desks to do all kinds of lab work or medical. They don't need anything. Okay? So you could take that over. Right? So they had to close it down, number one, because they used state money to and nobody could live in a house built with state dollars. So they couldn't actually use the project. But that idea came back to me when I saw the community scale lab, the OT faculty. And then English majors, digital storytellers, infrastructure for humanities and social sciences. That is the use of computational tools for statistical purposes and things of that nature, for analyzing huge amount of data. Archaeologists are using these heavy anthropologists. They're doing this for doing ethnographic studies, and so on and so forth. So, I'm 35 minutes into my talk, and I wanted to do it in 30 minutes. To develop 21st century leaders to serve the world, a mission that we're toying with. I think it requires a strong focus on math, science, humanities, and the arts. I strongly believe on that. The more I read about this, this is it. But making the connections is of the essence. This cannot exist in isolation, in silos, and technology is big on this. Okay? If we can embrace this, if we come up with that coherent curriculum, and I'm talking about the core curriculum, the general education curriculum, we have a winner. We have investigated this heavily. Bennington just did it 3 years ago. And they just looked at the curriculum and they came out more or less with the same conclusion. And it's fascinating. Talking to Tim Sellers, being a biologist, whatever it is that you are, Tim, different times I have different pictures. You're a man of multiple talents, I guess. Tim says, what about green? What if we have green in our curriculum? I said, you know what? I'll put that in the presentation and see what people think.
That's all of us. And not me.
I understand that you gave me the chalk. And this is great. And I have a conversation with you guys too. So, here's the idea. You know, we could have it in the curriculum, we have it in practice, we could have it in connections, you know, this dissemination of ideas. And again, technology will probably play a role. I talked to Tim. Cornell has a very interesting project funded by the National Science Foundation. They have an institute for computational sustainability. And what it is the use of computational technology in order to make the world more sustainable. They have an institute there. If you look at that, if you look at our webpage, they have mechanical engineers, they have humanists, they have anthropologists, they have biologists, they have computing people, they have all kinds of people looking at this issue. The flip side, which is what RIT is doing, is sustainable computing, which is the other way around. The first one is computational sustainability. It's computing to support sustainability. The other way is sustainable computing. It's computers using less energy, for example. And so on. So this is fascinating. We could spend the rest of the time here. So here's where I want to really emphasize. I want to issue a call to action. We want to put together a long-term planning steering committee. This group, a version of this group, already met. And this is what used to be called the Strategic Budget and Planning Committee. I think that was the name. And we decided that we need to formalize it. We would like to have 5 faculty representatives. We would like to have 5 staff representatives. 3 students, 2 from the alumni council, the whole 18, including me, and 3 board of trustees representatives. Okay? And we want to put together this committee as soon as I finish talking. There will be a letter coming out within a week. I'm traveling tomorrow's back, and the letter is not ready yet. Spend all of this out. And what we're going to do. There are going to be a bunch of task forces which will include more people. Okay? We will need people that will help us with revising the mission and vision. We're going to need people that will help us updating the external environment analysis. We're already doing some work on that. We're going to need people that will do the prioritization of academic program and services, the assessment of the effectiveness and efficiency. We're going to need a group of people that will look at the curriculum and revitalize it. Right? And we're going to need a group of people that will help us develop a master plan. Because it needs to include facilities, resources, and whatnot. Overwhelming? I'd like to quote from a colleague. If the question of where to start seems overwhelming, you are at the beginning, not at the end of this adventure. Being overwhelmed is the first step if you're serious about trying to get things that really matter. This woman, president of Bennington College, when she started this effort 3 years ago. Thank you for your attention. I hope this information is useful to you. And I hope that you are as excited as I am for the future. Thank you so much.